Hi friends, I'm Kat, and today we're going to talk about Shewhart control charts. So if you've seen Shewhart charts before, you can probably skip ahead to the demo, but I'd like to talk to you a little bit about what they are, how they work. Shewhart charts are a technique for measuring variability in a process over time. So you're looking at, for example, groups of observations that are measured once an hour, and you're comparing the variability between the means of the hours to the variability within an hour. So to talk to you a little more about that, so what is the aim of control charts? The aim of control charts is to separate signals from noise. In other words, how much variability is there in measurements of usually physical measurements, but how much variability is there in measurements of things for a process that's behaving consistently? There's going to be some amount of variability versus a process that has signals. So we're trying to separate signals from noise. And to give you an example of that, suppose that that you're baking cookies, right? So if I bake cookies at home, I really don't care if they're all the same size. I don't care if they're all the same shape. I just plop the cookies onto the cookie tin thing and I get a bunch of cookies. As long as they taste good, that's all that matters. However, if you're a commercial baker, you have a box. And that box has restrictions. And in this case, I'm drawing you a box with three columns. So I'm going to have three columns of cookies. And I have to fit exactly 10 cookies per column. So I need a box that holds 30 cookies. Well, the box size is already set. That means the cookie size has to be exactly consistent so that I can fit the same number of cookies every time in the box without leaving too much extra space left over. So that's what I'm trying to do. I'm trying to make sure that as I make cookies in my factory, that those cookies are all coming out the same size, and they're not some of them that are little bitty and some of them that are great big, but that they are all actually consistently the same size. Now, if I do that, suppose that I bake, you know, a few hundred cookies an hour. What I'll do is I will take a measurement of five cookies in the first hour, and I'll take five of those cookies off of the production line. I'll measure the diameter of each one, and I'll write them down and figure out what the average diameter is, and then I can plot that on a graph. So let's suppose that this y-axis here is the diameter. Okay, so that's the diameter. And on the x-axis is the hour. So at the first hour, the average diameter of my cookies is, let's say it's about 5.1. So I'm going to plot it right there. The second hour, I take my measurements, and let's say the average is about 4.9. And the third hour, I take measurements, and let's say it's 5.3. You know, so I've got these different measurements over time, and I can look at how much this process varies. Well, I'm going to compare this variability from time to time to the variability within, because remember that each of these measurements consisted of five cookies. So there are five cookie measurements. So if the typical variability within these samples is fairly small, then I'm going to expect these means to stay fairly close to the line. On the other hand, if I have the variability is really high, then I'm going to expect that typical variability to be much wider. And so that's what I'm comparing, is that between to the within. And how do we do that? We do that with a Shewhart chart. Shewhart charts are named after Walter Shewhart, and they're used for comparing the variability within means to variability between means or between measurements on a chart. So as we're taking these measurements and we're plotting them on a chart, this data will be plotted over time, and then we're going to add something called control limits. And those control limits are drawn at a distance of typically three standard deviations of the distribution of the statistic that you're plotting from the mean line, which is called the center line. And those observations are plotted in order, and any observations that fall outside of those control limits are known as out of control points. And your goal is to try to identify whether a process is in control or out of control, partly based on whether it falls inside or outside of those control limits. Now, most of these charts come in pairs with a chart for the location and another chart for dispersion. And the data in the dispersion chart, like I said, is used to estimate the variability or the standard deviation for the location chart. And the way that you measure that standard deviation also depends on the kind of data that's being plotted. So what kind of Shewhart chart will you use? This video, we're focused on Shewhart charts for measurement data. And the first question you want to ask is, are you measuring groups of observations at a time or just one observation at a time? We're going to talk about groups of observations, 5 cookies per hour. In that case, you might use an X bar and R chart or an X bar and S chart. And the X bar and R chart uses the range on that second chart, the variability chart, whereas the X bar and S chart uses the standard deviation. I'm going to show you how to do this in SAS. Okay, so I'm working with a data set called Cookies 1, in which I've taken 5 cookies per hour and measured them over a series of hours. And I'm going to use the Shewhart procedure. Here I'm using SAS Studio. This works whether you're using SAS Studio on SAS 9, if you're using SAS Studio on VIA. This works whether you're accessing SAS Studio through your own local installation of SAS or through SAS On Demand or through VIA for Learners. Doesn't matter, it's all the code will work the same way. So what I'm doing is I'm calling the Shewhart procedure, PROC Shewhart, and I specify the data set that I'm using, and I'm going to request an X bar and R chart with the XR chart statement. The structure of the XR chart statement is you name the process variable, then you put an asterisk, and then you specify the subgroup identifier, which in this case is hour. So if we run that, and then we get our results back, and this doesn't look good. You can see that on our mean and range chart, the mean chart, the mean for diameter, shows that there are these huge spikes, these big signals. Well, where are they happening? It looks like it's at 6 hours, 12, 18, 24. Something not right here. Every 6 hours, our diameters are too big. We have great big round giant cookies. So what can we do about that? Well, we're going to figure that out in just a second. I do want to show you, and really my preference is to use a standard deviation instead of the range, but X bar and R chart is very familiar to people, so that's how you get it. But how do you get an X bar and S chart? You simply change the statement to XS chart. Everything about the code stays exactly the same. So if I rerun this requesting the X bar and S chart, then we can see it looks very, very similar. The only difference is that these control limits are specified using a multiple of the average of the standard deviation rather than the range. And we can see that every 6 hours, the cookies are too wide. So what do we do about that? This is where we've got to go get close to the process. Once we get close to the process, what you do is you would literally watch people making the cookies and figure out what's happening. Let's say in this case, we realize that every 6 hours, all of the equipment gets cleaned. And at the end of the cleaning process, maybe there's a little bit of residual water left in the bottom of the bowls. And so your cookies are getting, the batter is just a little more thin and the cookies get wider and flatter. Well, there's our $1 million Six Sigma project. We're going to go in with a towel. We're going to use PROC towel, and we're going to dry out that bowl. And once we do that, we can go in and bake more cookies. So here we have Cookies 2, a new data set with our new cleaning process that uses a towel to dry out the bowl. And when we do that, we're requesting an X bar and S chart once again, plotting diameter by hour. And this time we have no signals. Yay! So this time we say, oh, good, the process is in control. Now, this is an important point. The first function of a control chart is to tell you whether your process is in control or out of control. If the process is out of control, then those control limits are not useful for predicting future behavior of the data. So the first thing you've got to do is get the process in control. Once we've done that, here we have it. We got our process in control. We say, yay. Now we can actually use these limits, this 5.0591 and this 4.9406. That is a range in which we expect the means of the cookie diameters, if you measure 5 an hour, to fall in the future, if you keep on measuring out into the future. And so what we're going to do is save those limits to a data set. Here I'm using the out limits equals option to save out a data set called work.underscore limits. And when you run that, it will put that set of limits in a data set. And I'm actually just going to reapply it in the very next run of PROC Shewhart here with limits equals work.underscore limits, using the same cookies to data. But I could actually apply that to any data set with cookies. In fact, you know what? To prove it to you, I'm going to apply it to a different data set. So we can save the limits out, and then we apply those limits to new data. All right, there we go. So the first thing you'll see looks exactly like what you saw before. It was our process, but with those limits, but we saved them out. And then in the next chart, this is the cookies one data set, but it's actually using the limits applied from the cookies two data set. So that's a, you know, great example of when you would use a Shewhart control chart. Other times you might use Shewhart charts is if you're manufacturing something and you're taking measurements of component parts over time. If you're in a service industry and you have key performance indicators for things like wait times or number of mistakes that are made in document processing. All kinds of great uses of Shewhart charts. So I hope you found this helpful. Lots of ways that you can use PROC Shewhart for grouped measurement data. So if you liked this video, if you got something out of it, make sure you click like. Leave me a comment down below. I'd love to hear what you all are thinking. Check out the resources down in the list below. You'll see links to the data set that I used. You'll find links to documentation and some training. Check it all out. Good stuff. I'm looking forward to seeing you next time. And don't forget to subscribe to the SAS Users channel. Until next time.